Hi friends, welcome to my channel Cloud TV. In this video I am going to discuss about a Scala fundamentals. Okay, let's start with the introduction to Scala. Scala means scalable language. Scala is some people pronounce Scala Scala, so based on your convenience, you can do that. So Scala is object-oriented programming language and also functional programming language. So it is also called hybrid language. So if you want to getting a lot of details about Scala, you can visit those two documentation page. Okay, the Scala has it's a good amount of documentation for its features. It has, okay, so you can just go and explore it. So let me give a brief introduction about what is object-oriented programming and what is functional programming language. Then we'll see what are the comparison. We'll see a few comparison about these two languages and how some of the features from object-oriented and function programming has been implemented in Scala. Okay, so let's start with object-oriented programming language. It's shortly called OOP. Okay, object-oriented programming is a programming model which is based on objects. Okay, so using this we can actually visualize real-world scenarios or real-world objects. Okay, for example, if you take a person class in this diagram, okay, so it will have there's a three box over, right? So three box actually represent three classes. Okay, so top the person class is called a base class or the super class. Okay, and the student and employees are called the derived class or the subclass. Okay, so subclass or child class you can say, and the person is a parent class. So say if we take a program, okay, the program has two basic elements. One is data and operation that you want to work on the data. So if you see in the person class, so name and address of the date it represents, or it can hold data of name and address. And if you see get name, it's operation that you apply on the name data. Okay, so name field or name data which is going to hold the name of the person. Okay, so in object-oriented programming, okay, both data and operations will be sitting on the same place or the centralized place. Okay, so you can actually create multiple instances of class called object. Okay, objects are released to the related to the what you have under the relevance. So example, if you have a person class here, so person is derived, employee class. If you take employee class, you can create multiple employees for a particular organization. Okay, so the employee class will have a name and address which is derived from person class, and also it can have multiple properties or the data it can represent, like salary, what is the company the employee belongs to, and the operations like get salaries, set salary, and set company, get company. So similarly, you can have student class as a child class which is derived from person class. Okay, so it will have properties which is derived from the parent class, which is a person, and it might have its own properties and operations which it can perform. Okay, so this is the short introduction about object-oriented programming. Let's see what is the functional programming, and let's compare both of them. Okay, so functional programming. In pure functional programming, there is no concept of class and objects, which means data and operations that you work on the data are not in the centralized location, so they are separate. Okay, so in functional programming, it treats data and operations are two different things, hence they kept separate. Okay, so the idea of in functional programming is you just take a big job, okay, and break into tiny or small manageable functions, where each function will be tend to do specific work, or which is meant for to do specific work. That's how the functional programming works. Now let's compare object oriented and function programming and understand how it is achieving different properties or different features. So in the object oriented, as we said, everything is real world representation. So you if you take shape as a base class, from the shape a base class you can derive different shapes like square, rectangle, triangle kind of things. So everything is you can relate to the real world scenarios. But in the functional programming, everything is with respect to the functions what you are going to apply on the data. So it's all data transformations related. Okay, and functional programming highly adapts immutability. That means the original data will not be modified. It's immutable. It highly supports immutable. So if you want to generate a new instance from the original data, always the copy of the original data is taken and it's been processed based on that data. Okay, so you always have original data untouched. Okay, so but in case of object oriented language, it also supports immutability with certain limitations. Okay, so over period of the time, your original data might be changed in the object oriented programming, but not in the case of functional programming. Okay. And object-oriented language may support higher-order function. Functional programming supports higher-order function. We'll see with example what is higher-order function. Okay, so functions are, as we said previously, data and functions are kept separately in functional programming. But all functions and data are grouped in the class. Okay, in object-oriented programming. So object-oriented programming follows imperative programming, where you will not have where you will have actually step-by-step procedure what you need to do. But in functional programming, it's a declarative programming model, so you will not have step-by-step procedure. So because of its step-by-step procedure in object-oriented programming, execution out of the statement is very important. But in case of functional programming, it is not important. And basically is how object oriented programming looks like is so object oriented programming focus on how you are doing the work or the task you want to do. So or you want to how you want to express your real world object in terms of object in class. But in case of functional programming, it's focus on what you are doing basically. So it'll do the task done by using the lot of transformation and operations using functional programming. Okay, so we'll see how these features are being implemented in Scala. Okay, so let's do some hands-on. We'll understand how it is implemented. The Scala is basically a very concise language. So basically, you can write in code in very concise manner, which means whatever the code you write in Java, okay, that same code can be written in few lines of code in Scala. So if you look at the in this slide, so I am planning to create an employee class with the two properties, name and salary. Okay, so and I am planning to have a setter and getter methods and constructor. So I write a Java program. So employee.java, okay. And my package name is com.ctv.java. So I create an employee, okay, employee class with two properties. So I need to write a getter method and setter method, okay, so and a constructor. So it takes around more than 10 lines of code, right? But same thing I can do in Scala with one lines of code. So class name, employee is my class name, and there are two properties I have, which is name of type string, and another property is salary of type int. Okay, so in Scala, everything is Everything here, sorry, in functional programming, everything will actually express it in very concise manner. Okay, so Scala will automatically will generate a constructor for your class, and it will say it will actually write a getter and setter method for your properties. Okay, so if you see string and integers, string and int are not a primitive type here, it's all object, but in case of Java, the int 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 is a primitive type. Okay, so you cannot apply two string function on the primitive type. Okay, but in the case of Java you can do, sorry, in case of Scala you can do all the things we can actually explore using a programming. Okay, so I'm going to use ID called Scala ID. So there are many IDs available to do Scala programming. Like one of the ID famous ID is Scala ID. Okay, so using that you can write a Scala program as well as Scala, you can create Scala project as well as the Java project, and you can. Some people are using IntelliJ IDE. It is also good. I am also used to work with the IntelliJ IDE. Most of my Spark job I used to write in IntelliJ IDE. So if you want to download the Scala IDE and work on, you just go to this website scala-ide.org. Okay, where you can get this IDE, you can download this IDE. Okay, it's almost same as Eclipse only. Okay, so and what you need is you just need a JDK 8 to 1.8 to work with this in Scala IDE. So I already downloaded and set up in my local system. So if you look at here, I have two projects. Okay, let me save this. Okay, let me close these two. Okay, so one is it's a Java project. You can see the perspective is showing Java, and this is a Scala project. Okay, both looks the structure, project structure is same. Okay, so look at here, the employee class like this, looks like this. Okay, it's only two property, but you need to write a lot of coding in the Java, but the same employee class can be written in only few lines. Okay, so ignore this print employee method. I will discuss later. So basically this is the definition of employee class in Scala, very simple, right? Okay, so so that's what I wanted to say in this class. Okay, so if you want to create some more property, you can just do where department. Say example, you have already name and salaries is two properties, right? So if you want to have one more property, you can say where department equal to shortly we call it as DEPT equal to zero. Okay, so we are saying department as zero. So if I just want to print the employee details, okay, I'll just create a method called print employee. Okay, so def keyword represents, this is the method. Okay, so it is doesn't have any arguments, you just going to print the name of the employee makes how much salary. So example, John makes a salary of this many USD kind of things. Okay, sorry for the interruption. Okay, so this is a simple method, right? And then if you want to create a, so basically so we created a class here, so we need actually entry point to execute this class. Okay, so similar like Java, we need a entry point for this program. Okay, so basically we need to have a main method. Okay, so I am creating a object demo. Object the sense it is a singleton. When you say particular class is an object or class or maybe whatever you call this, if we want to declare an object, okay, use the object keyword, okay, not for the class. Basically it's you define a class as object, okay. So that means it's a singleton. Singleton means it will have only one instance of a demo, okay. So inside that you should have a main method, okay. This will be our entry point of the program. Inside the main method, so it else the main method is call also have a the string array as argument, okay, and it returns nothing. So unit means void in Java, okay. So then what I am actually creating is inside this main method I am going to create a object for employee, okay. So to create object you use the new keyword, okay, and employee name of the class, and we pass the arguments. There are two arguments which needs to be passed, okay. One is the name of the employee and what is the salary is getting. So you create the object. So if then I just print the objects like name of the employee and name of the salary the employee is getting, so using this object, okay. So you can print it. And then if you want to set the salary, you can just say object dot salary equal to this much and you can print it, okay. So let me execute this, okay, and also I am calling this print employee method using the object. Let me run this. So call application. So you see employee name is Arun and is getting 40,000 and 40,000. Then you can actually modify the employee, okay. So from 40,000 to 50,000 and you can print, okay. So then okay, so if I want to set my department, okay, my department as 10, okay. So department right now currently it is assigned as 0, it's not meaningful. So if you want to define a department as 10 with a string value, but it throws error, okay. What it says is type mismatch found string of 10 required int. That means Scala is actually type inference language. So when you assign 0 to the variable department, it actually infers this will be an integer type, okay. And where keyword is nothing but it will change it. So meaning it is mutable, it is not immutable. When you use val keyword, it is immutable. We'll discuss in the another program, okay. So basically what it says is the type of the department is already inferred as integer, so you cannot assign the string value. So and also if you see before running itself, it says means it is static type checking language Scala. So basically during the compile time itself it will find out the issue if any compile error is occurs. So it will not allow string value. So let's command this, okay. If then you assign a department 10 to the employee, then it accepts. So let me print that, okay. Employee object dot department, okay. So if you print, let me save this and run. Okay, so it says department as 10. From 0 we assigned as 10, it is able to. So basically from this program what you need to understand is Scala is a type inference language and it is a static type language checking language, and so it is very you can write a program in very very tiny manner, means it's very concise. Basically you can write code in few lines of code, you can achieve a lot of operations. You can do it, you can achieve a lot of functionality to be implemented in few lines of code, okay. So then we'll see one more example to understand higher order function and function and methods in Scala, okay. So I just created another class called function demo. Okay, so function demo. Okay, we'll go one by one. Okay, so it has one function, one method called m1. Okay, how do you say it's a method? Function as a def keyword. If a function has if it is a function or method as a def keyword, it's a method actually. So if you look at here, it takes argument as integer, okay, string integer value. The variable name is string, sorry, the variable name is x, and the type is integer. And what it does, what is the logic it does, is it just increment the current value with one, so x value with one. So if I want to define a function, so this is how I can define a function. Val, I said val means it's immutability. Okay, so val f1 is a function name. Okay, equal to, I am having an argument. Okay, one argument, which is x as argument name, and it is of type integer. And if you see, there is a special operator. It says the current x value will be increment by 1. So this operator, right, and whatever the law, code or the statement of right side of this operator is the logic for the function, function body. So this is the function argument. Okay, so I can define f2 with the same like this. So basically, this is how function and methods are defined in Scala. So we can call this f1 and f2. Okay, so similarly, I create an object with the demo function demo, and we'll have main method. And I'm going to create an object for function demo class, which we defined in the top. Okay, I'm going to call first. Okay, so let me comment out this all. Okay, so we create a method m1, which takes input as integer and adds by 1. F1, F2 also said the same thing, but those two are functions and m1 is a method. So let me execute this. So I'm passing 10, so it get increment by 1, so 11 we are getting as in output. Okay, so next thing what I want to discuss about is, okay, so so I am actually create a function with no argument. So that's, this is how we can do. So basically the function called a simple string fun, okay, function, it takes zero argument. Okay, and this is the body of the function. So it says just string fun, okay, string value, hi, how are you. And I can also define a function which takes argument. Okay, so we saw this like this before. So basically you can specify the input argument. Okay, so x is integer type. So if you want multiple lines of code in your function body, you can use a curly braces to embrace your code. Okay, so basically what I am doing is checking a function called event odd. Okay, so the input value is whether it's even or odd. Yes, it says if x mod 2 is 0, it's even number or it's odd number. So let us execute these two functions and check how it is working. So I'll comment out, okay, uncomment these two lines of code. So I'll call using the this object of the function demo class. I'll call this simple string function and even or function. So when I execute this, I'm going to get the simple string which I printed, I have you, and the number which I passed to is the even number. Okay, so let's now discuss what is higher order function. Okay, let me minimize this recording window. Okay, so what is higher order function. Okay, so before going to higher order function, let's see what is how we can define anonymous functions. Okay, So I create a function called sumSalary. So from the last class we from the last class we saw, which is employee class, let's create a few of the instances of the class or object of the class. So I create a file object to represent five persons, five employees in any organization. Okay, so Arun, Ranjit, Rohit, Arvind, and Akhit are the five employees. So they belong to different departments and they get draw different salaries. Okay, so if we want to create a list out of these five employee objects instance, so I just create a list. Okay, it's a collection object. Okay, so list, and you open a bracket with passing five objects. So it will create the list of five objects. Okay, so I am going to pass this to the function called sumSalary. What I am going to do is I take a list of employees, right? List of employees. I am going to iterate each employee and sum of this salary, sum of all employees' salary, and return a sum of all employees' salary. So to do that, list to operate, iterate each operator, iterate each element in the list. You can use the for each function. Okay, so and it takes when you do that, so you take each employee object, right? So this is the this is where you mentioning each employee object is taken, and from that employee salary is taken and is summed up. Okay, so if you see, this is the another function. Okay, means it is anonymous function. There is no name for this function, but it does some kind of calculation, right? So that's this is how you define an anonymous function. So what you say is you can also write in this way. So same sumSalary one. So it takes list of employees, okay, and you iterate each employee and say E. So it is type. Type inference language, right? So E is employee, instance of employee, and it takes each employee salary and does the summing. Okay, and when you say, so there is no written keyword you can in the Scala. So basically, what are the last value specify, it actually adds up the return statement, and the value will be returned to the when you call this function. So let us call this function and find out the sum of all salaries. So what I'm trying to say, this is a way you define anonymous functions. Okay, so let me comment out this also. It's going to return same value. Let's run this. Yeah, so all the employee salary sum up, it's a 16,000. Okay, say example, if you want to find out a sumSalary for specific department, okay, department 10. So you can write the code. You just apply a filter condition before summing up, like whether department employees department equal to 10. Okay, you can do that. Suppose you want to do for another department, then again you need to write or you need to again duplicate this function and make it for another department. Okay, but if you have more department, then it is the code will be very very what is there, you will have duplication of lot of duplication code. Okay, to avoid that, okay, we can actually pass function as a input to the or argument to the another function, okay, which is called higher order function. So a function is called as higher order function if it is as one or more function as input or arguments, and it may return a function as a output. Okay, so I create a function called sumSalary higher order function. Okay, it takes same list of employees as one argument. If we see another argument, it is a function. Okay, so basically name of the function is selection. Okay, and it is going to take input as employee. Okay, employee, and it will return boolean. Okay, boolean as a output. Okay, so inside your for each inside for each function call. So before summing up, you are going to do check whether the employees of what are the logic you given while passing the while passing input to this function. Okay, so basically so it takes that employee. Okay, if that employee is after this employee is validated using the selection functions, okay, so it will return either true or false as a boolean value, right? If it is a true only, it will go and do the sum of the salaries. Okay, if you look at the when you call this function, let's check what is the logic being passed. Okay, so let me uncomment this and sorry for the interruption. So basically if you look in uncomment this, okay, let's see. So we are going to call this sum salary higher order function. It takes a list of employees and say this is the logic you specified while actually calling the function. So this logic is the this is the logic of the your selection function. Okay, so what it takes is it takes argument as employee. Okay, and it checks whether the employee department is greater than 10. Okay, so it will sum up only the employees whose department is greater than 10. Okay, so for each employees the selection each employee, okay, in the list, okay, the selection function will be called and a particular logic is executed. If it returns boolean true, it goes and sum up. So if you look at here, we have two employees with this having department 11 and 13, which is 2000 as salary and 1000, so it has to return 3000 as a sum of salary. Let's run this. Yeah, 3000 returns. So from this program, what we learned is we can define a anonymous function using this kind of syntax. You can define an anonymous function and you can define a higher order function like this. The higher order function is a function which takes one or more input as a function and then we return a function output as a function. Okay, so so there are a lot of features available in Scala, like for multiple to implement the inheritance, we have a concept called traits, okay, in Scala, and also there are a lot of concepts like pattern matching, all the very important concepts in Scala. So we'll slowly learn those two concepts when you do the Spark programming. So basically I want to give quick introduction about Scala so that when I write a Spark code with Scala, so you get familiar. So for the sessions we'll be focusing on the Scala RDD Spark RDD transformation and actions. Okay, so we'll be doing both using Scala and Python. Okay, please subscribe to my channel Cloud TV, okay, to get more technology videos. Okay, thank you so much, friends.